I feel privileged in welcoming Dr. Lipika Sahu, who is the founder and CEO of Life Intellect Consultancy Private Limited. Life Intellect Consultancy is a Bangalore-based technological and intellectual property consulting firm. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you.
I welcome Professor Ravi Shankar, Dean Placements. I welcome Professor Ranjan Manish, HOD I4 and Alumni Relations, the inspiring mind presence of this. I also welcome Professor Balaji, Coordinator, IIC NCET, Professor Geetanjali, HOD MBA and ED Cell. I would like to extend a heartily welcome to our faculty members and our beloved students. As all of you are aware that the topic of the session is intellectual property rights, and throughout the history of evolution, human beings have emerged as creatures with intellectual prowess. It is this immense brain power that sets us apart from other species. From the early stages of human civilization, we have used our skills and ingenuity to discover and develop several notable inventions such as wheel, weaponry, methods of agriculture, etc. Over the time, human beings brought about leaps in creativity. The world in which we are as we know it today is a result of these human inventions. Gradually, it became to be recognized that these man-made creations were a valuable and significant asset. The term intellectual property was coined to refer to all these works that generate from an innovative mind in which a person's thinking, reasoning, creative, and analytical skills are put to use. As is evident from the name given to it, these works were recognized as intangible property of the creator, and thus, like with all property, the law sought to grant it statutory protection. Thus, legislations began to incorporate statutes and laws specifically addressing intellectual property. Though these laws took different forms in different countries, the fundamental aspects covered by them remained constant throughout the world. Firstly, the statutes were meant to lay down specifics regarding the ownership of the intellectual property and the rights associated with such ownership. Secondly, they address the conditions and situations under which infringement of such rights could be said to have occurred. Lastly, they provided for legal sanctions in case of such infringement so as to safeguard the rights of the owners. In this regard, Dr. Lipika Sahu will be addressing all of us, like what would be the basic framework of intellectual property rights in India and how it is different from industry to industry, and what are the contemporary cases or the judgments which we have seen over a period of time. You know, all these records, she will be throwing some light on these things. Now, introducing Dr. Lipika Sahu, she is a registered Indian patent and trademarks agent with 21 years of rich experience in both academia and industry in the area of technology, innovation, and intellectual property. She holds a PhD from Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. She also holds triple masters, a Master of Science from Sambalpur University, Odisha, a postgraduate diploma in intellectual property rights law from National School of India University, Bangalore, a postgraduate certification in business management from Xavier Institute of Management, Bhubaneswar, patents and patent drafting. She is also an alumna of IIM Bangalore. Prior to Life Intellect, she had worked with various MNCs and law firms. She has rich experience in patent drafting, IP office actions, IP analytics, training and developing teams, project development, coordination, and networking with scientists, inventors, or business owners from different parts of the world. And her specialties include biomedical science, drug discovery and development, product development, pharmaceutical, healthcare, life sciences, intellectual property, IP analytics, patents, drafting, business development, branding, strategic management, mentoring, consultancy, and entrepreneurship and technology consulting. She has been associated with many startup ecosystems, trained startups or inventors at CCE, AMP, IIMB, IISE, KIIT, Startup Square Bangalore, Vellore Institute of Technology, Bio Innovation Center Bangalore, PhD Chamber of Commerce and Industry. She has mentored India Innovation Challenge Teams, a program being organized by Texas Instruments, Department of Science and Technology, IIM Bangalore. She is an invited speaker for many conferences, webinars, and workshops. I hope all of us will cherish the 1.5 hour session and the quantum of information she will bring on the table for every one of us to remember and get exposed to the world of intellectual property rights. Thank you, ma'am, for being the guest of the day.
Thank you so much. My apology for some delay glitch in my system. So that's how it got delayed for some time. We'll try to cover during the session whatever time we have taken extra. And first of all, I would like to thank Nagarjuna College of Engineering, Dr. Rajneesh, the faculties and students who are present here. So today, we'll be talking about intellectual property rights. Thank you so much for the wonderful introduction. And hopefully, after today's session, all the students and the participants present here will have some idea about how is it the intellectual property can help us and how can we protect it and how does it help in our day-to-day life as a student or as a faculty or when you start a company. So can you all see my screen?
Yes, ma'am, visible.
Yeah. Okay. So we will keep it as interactive session because 1.5 hour, if one way talking would be really boring. So I would ask you some questions so you can answer in the chat box and then that's how we will go on with the presentation. So when we talk about intellectual property, what exactly you mean by intellectual property? Like you would have heard that, okay, this is how people call about IPR and what are the different kinds of, what do you think, what is the intellectual property? You can type in the chat box. I think some idea of what exactly do you mean by intellectual? Is it something, some property like you can buy, sell, or what exactly? I think students can participate. What do you think? What is intellectual property? Intellectual property refers to creation of mind. Okay, very good. Creativity or ideas. Okay, very good answer. Yeah, I think both are very good answers. So basically, when we talk about intellectual property, it is whatever you can think of, whatever you can create with your mind. It could be something about like creating an image or design or some artistic work or inventions or literary work. So anything you can create out of your mind is called intellectual property. And these property can be protected through certain way, like how the physical property you buy, sell, and you have your ownership of that property. So like that, this intellectual property also, you can protect it in certain way. Different kinds of ideas can be protected in different ways through different domains of intellectual property. So we will talk about that a little later. Now, why we are so careful about creating and protecting intellectual property? So if you see earlier days, it was industrial age, then 19th century, it was electrical age, then late 19th, it was IT and biotech age. And then in 21st century, usually they say that the leadership is with the company or the individual who create and harness knowledge. If you see Fortune 100 companies, more than 85% of their asset are in form of intellectual property rights. It's not the brick and mortar or the kind of machinery they have, the kind of manpower they have. It is more than that. It is about how much IP or intellectual property right that company has created. So this is how more than 85% of these 100 Fortune 100 companies have their IP, have their asset in form of intellectual property rights. So what are the mechanisms of protecting these IP rights? These are something like your fundamental right or your natural right, something like right to education, right to speech, or you have to apply to the government to get this right. So these are the rights mostly. Typically, you have to, once you create it, you have to write to the government in certain process, apply for the specific government offices, and then get it examined. And once it is examination is through and the examiner is satisfied, you get a grant of patents or registration of your trademark or registration of your copyright. So these are the things usually happen. But there are certain kind of copyrights, a certain kind of IP, which you don't have to apply to get a right. Automatically, you get the right once you create it. So we'll talk about that. And you get the IP rights based on the value that you create, because government is only giving you the certificate of grant, but it is up to you. You have to take the idea forward to the market. So this is how the IP strategy, the things work. Like as a inventor or as a creator, you might have certain patents or many design applications or copyrights, but unless you take those rights to market, you won't get any economic rewards. It's up to you to take those ideas forward to the market. Now, if you see in different patent offices across the world, there are around, say, 3.3 million patents filed worldwide in 2004 to 2018, and that number is every year increasing. So these are the different patent applications filed across the world in different patent offices. And if I can give you some examples of different kinds of ideas and innovations, your ideas may not be complex or may not be something research driven. It can be very simple, but useful. As long as it is useful, you get some value out of it. So this one is hypodermic bunny. In 1967, this was a syringe. It was used to immunize small children, and it was quite popular at that time because children are scared of injections. So this inventor came up with this hypodermic bunny syringe. It was very popular, such a simple idea and very popular. This one is called crayon holder. In 2002, it was invented by a 10-year-old kid. So now see here, the idea need not have to be somebody who is thoroughly into research or doing some academic activity. It could come to small children also, because here, what happens when we use crayon, when it becomes smaller, we usually throw it. And I came up with this crayon holder idea. And even the crayon is still small, you can still use it. And the idea was bought by a company and the family was well compensated. So it can be a simple idea. It can come to a child, kid up for 10-year-old to 70-year-old. So there is no bar who can get the creative idea, who can get some idea which is protectable, and who can get the idea that that is useful to other to normal humans. So this is the simple idea. You can patent it. This is maybe even if you're a young kid also can have the idea to patent and make useful invention. And the other one is, this one is apparatus. Another example is apparatus for facilitating walking. It was patented in 1890. It was one of the first apparatus for helping the disabled to walk. So useful. So these are the ideas. They are useful. They may be simple. They may be complex. As long as it is useful, it is something worth patenting. This one is banana suitcase. Banana suitcase, it was patented in 2003. When you export banana to one country to other, what happens is that a lot of damages happen during the export. So here the inventor came up with this idea of banana suitcase, where it helps in export, very useful product for agricultural export. So So these are all variety of ideas that you see. This is very simple. It's called a paperclip. It was patented in 1909. It is so useful that even now, today, after 100 years also, we are still using it. This is clip, which we are using it for like clipping our papers and other things. Now, this one is IBM's futuristic comfort wear in 2017. IBM came up with this idea of comfort wear, wherein the user, when it is wearing this kind of comfort wear, the temperature within the comfort wear changes according to the weather temperature. So this is something very different, something very unique. IBM came up with this idea. Then it is Walmart's robotic bees. In 2018, Walmart patented this robotic bees because, you know, bees are very important for our food production, for our agricultural output, and our bees population are declining. So Walmart came up with this robotic bees. So these are variety of ideas, variety of products you are seeing. It can be simple, it can be complex, and that can be patented. So those, whatever you saw are different kinds of product. Here you see different kind of process. This one is Carly Talks, is something like you like the, most of us like the maybe taste of garlic, but we don't like the breath of garlic. So this company came up with this product called Carly Talks, where you have the taste, but you don't have the flavor of that garlic. And this is quite a popular product. And this one is Starfix. Starfix is a sticker, you put it on fruit, and which will keep the fruit 50% longer because it is this coating is made of beeswax, and this one is generally this is considered GRS certified, this product, which will help you to keep the food longer due to some kind of technology what they have used. These are different kind of processes. Here in these processes, they are process innovation, you can say here. So here what happens is this kind of father's farm in New York City, where they have used the supercritical carbon dioxide temperature to pasteurize food. And what happens? You don't have to add artificial preservative to store food for longer time. And the energy used, the storage of time of the food is still, energy use is less. The longer the time also you can store the food during this process. So this is a process innovation that people have used, and it's a patented technology. Other one is robotic chef to make your pizza. They have used it in Paris. They have put it as a pizza kiosk, where you can ask the robot to make the pizza in this 30 seconds. Usually you take 30 minutes. Here usually you can assert many different combination of pizza in just 30 seconds. It will assert and give you the pizza. So these are different kinds of process innovation that you are seeing. Okay, so now what all we saw till now, now you have your idea, and you either the idea could be a process or could be a product. And these are all novel ideas. And these are all inventive, means somebody doesn't come up with this idea regularly or every day. They would have put some time and effort to come up with these ideas. And they have certain kinds of industrial applicability. Means it can be used in the industry, it is useful for somebody. And these are all different kinds of technology. One could be in, say, biology, one could be in chemistry, or it could be in, say, when we are talking about, say, different kinds of IP related to paintings and other things, there could be some creativity. So these are different kind of technology. And what are these? And these are protected through some legal means. So these are legal protection of your idea. So that's called intellectual property rights. So your intellect is in form of property. It's protected in through legal measures. And these documents, what you prepare to file and protect your idea, these are all techno-legal documents. So somebody who has a knowledge of technology and who has a knowledge of law will be able to protect these ideas. And in turn of the process, you get certain rights, and these rights are called intellectual property rights. So if I can summarize, we have different kinds of ideas. These ideas can be products, this idea can be processes, and most of the time these ideas are novel ideas, and these are not generally common ideas, these are inventive ideas, and they have certain kind of industrial applicability, and you create different kinds of legal right by protecting this idea, these are called intellectual property rights. Okay, so with that background, let's move forward with let's more deeper into what are the different kinds of intellectual property, what are the different ways we can protect our ideas. So if I can ask you, like, what are the different kinds of IP rights that you know? If I can ask you to put it in the chat box. What do you think? What are the different kinds of IP rights that you know? I mean, it could be anything, whatever you think, it's okay. I think you can write, maybe it's sometime you know or you don't know, doesn't matter. We can discuss and we can take it forward. Yeah, Ms. Rajeshwari said it is designs. Okay, what other kinds of IP rights you think? Okay, copyrights, patents, trademark. Yeah, Mr. Akhil. Trade secrets, yeah. Very good answers. Any other answer? Okay, so what happens is there are a lot of different kind of intellectual property rights. Utility model, yeah. There are different kinds of IP rights that we have. Let us talk about what are the different kinds of IP rights that we have. They are patents, copyrights, secrets, intellectual property, trade secrets, industrial designs, geographical indications, plant varieties, traditional knowledge, integrated circuits, biodiversity. So these are all different kinds of IP rights that we have, and your idea, depending on what kind of idea you have and what kind of domain that you are going to use it and what kind of protection you require, depending on that, you can protect your idea through these different kinds of IP rights. And today we'll be talking about, considering the time that we have, we'll talk about five basics IP rights that you mamas should understand, and understand the way, what kind of protection it gives you, what is the strength of the protection, and how many years you can protect these ideas. So these are the basic thing that we'll be talking about. Okay, so let's start with trademarks. So what do you understand by a trademark? I think it's a quite commonly known, you read a lot of things, trademark infringement by this company, and this is what it is happening. So what do you think, what is a trademark? What kind of ideas can be protected through your trademark protection? Logo, yeah, very good. Okay. Any other thing that you can protect other than trademarks? Any other thing other than logo that you can protect to trademark? Symbols. Words which is legally registered. Okay, captions. Yeah, very good answers. Yeah, basically, when we say trademark, usually it could be something like, it could be a mark like McDonald's, or it could be a BPL, or it could be a device mark. Device picture, like a Coca-Cola bottle picture, or it could be a label, you can write a Coca-Cola, or it could be a name like a Tata, Birla, or it could be a number like 007. 007 is a very strong trademark. Or it could be a word like Life Intellect, Enforces, Java. So these are the different kinds of thing. And packaging, combination of colors, sound by, like, see, when you see MGM pictures, there is a roaring of lions, so that's the trademark of MGM pictures. Smell also can be a trademark. So these are the different kind of thing that you can protect through your trademark registration. So basically, trademark is a source identifier. Like, you can identify one company from other because of the trademark. And it creates certain kind of value, certain kind of authenticity. Say, when you talk about a product from, say, Infosys, or you talk about a product from Tata, you're talking about a product from Birla. So you had a certain kind of trust or confidence factor in this product of this company. Or when you talk about Apple or Samsung, you know what you expect from a product of these companies. So user has certain kind of confidence and threshold of quality when they talk about a product from a particular company. And terms, how many years do you think trademarks are protected? Hello, Dr. Priya. Yeah, how many years you think trademarks are protected? It should be easy. Do you think it's some 20 years, 30 years, 40 years? What do you think? How many years the trademarks are protected? Come on, it is not that difficult. How many years do you think? 10 years, okay. Yeah. So Ms. Rimam says 10 years and Mr. Akhay says 10 years. Okay. Any other answer? So everyone only like trademarks to be 10 years? So how many years the Coca-Cola companies? How many years do you think Coca-Cola companies? Is it 10 years old? So since when we all are drinking Coca-Cola? So only 10 years? Or any other answer? So we have 126 participants, 40 years. Kavita Swami said 40 years. I'm sorry, there may be doctors, there may be professors. I just read the names on the chat box. Might not be acknowledging the right name. 15 years. Okay. 20 years. Okay, thank you so much for the answer. So now, as we see that Coca-Cola trademark is still a valid trademark. They are not, they are not out of that trademark rights. So Coca-Cola company is 150 years old. It's more than 150 years old. So what I mean to say, the trademarks are the only one kind of property right, intellectual property right. They have perpetual existence. Means every 10 years, you just pay the renewal fee to the government, it is your trademark. As long as it is used in trade, it is your trademark. As long as you're paying the renewal fee once in a 10 years to the government, it is your trademark. This is very important to remember. So the longer the time it is used in the market, the more value of your trademark. So now if we see here, Coca-Cola, just value of this Coca-Cola trademark is 81 billion. Forget about the kind of the factory they have, the people they have, the machinery they have, excluding all that, the kind of, say, trade secret they have or patents they have, excluding all that, just the trademark, value of the trademark Coca-Cola is 81 billion. Value of this IBM trademark is 86 billion. Just the word IBM. So the longer the time it is used in the market, the value they are creating for their customer, the more the higher the value of your trademark. Okay. So this is what something very important that we have understood. And if we have any question for trademark, we'll take one or two questions. Otherwise, we'll move forward. You can unmute and ask if you have one or two questions. Otherwise, we'll move forward with copyrights. Okay. So Dr. Ranjan, can we take all the question answer towards the end, around 12:15 or so?
Yes, ma'am. I think that was the right thing.
Okay.
Maybe after the session.
Okay, fine. So we'll do that. So now moving to the copyright. Copyright is when you express an idea. So that's the way you can protect your copyright. It's like a right to copy. You have the right to copy what you have created. And unless otherwise you have given your right to copy it to somebody else, they can't copy it. So you only have the right to copy. So that's your copyright. So now, if I ask you a question, so if you have the idea of a story and you told that idea to your friend and your friend went ahead and wrote the story, so whose copyright it will be? Whether it will be yours or your friend's? It's quite simple, right? What do you think? Whether it's, if it is your idea, you told your friend and friend went ahead and wrote the book. So ultimately, it will be whose copyright? Your copyright or your friend's copyright? So how many of you think it is your copyright? Friend's copyright, friend's. Okay, everybody wants to give credits to friend, not yourself. Okay, so why do you think it is your friend's copyright? Basically, it is all your idea, right? You only told everything to your friend. So why do you think it is your friend's copyright? But I need to articulate. Yeah, okay. So this is a very important point. When you have the idea, in case of copyright protection, the way it is expressed, the protection comes only for the expression, not for the idea. This is very, very important for you to understand. If you're talking about a case of patent, in that case, you are stopping it at the idea stage. You can stop others to copy your idea itself. But whereas in case of copyright, it is the way it is expressed that is what protected. Like we have Taj Mahal. Everybody goes to Taj Mahal, take the pictures. Whoever takes the picture, it is their copyright. The photo is their copyright. Okay, so it is very important. It has to be expressed in some sort of tangible form. Like if you say you have done some sand painting. So that is not fixed. That's not tangible. So you won't get a copyright for that. As long as it is fixed in some certain form, then it can be copyrighted. Okay. And it has to have some sort of originality or creativity. And that originality, creativity may not be at the level of Picasso, but it should have some level of originality or creativity. That is what it requires. And what are the kind of things that you can protect from copyright? It could be dramatic, artistic work, musical work, sound recording, photographic, all these kind of work are protected through copyright. And there are a lot of rights come along with the copyright. Like we say it is a bundle of rights. So you can translate it, you can adapt it, you can make copies of it, you can print it. So all these rights comes along with copyright protection. There is, in the beginning of the talk, we discussed that some sort of IP rights, you don't have to apply to get a copyright. But as soon as you create, it is your copyright. So copyright protection is one of those intellectual property rights, whereas you don't have to apply to the government to protect it. As soon as you finish writing a letter or you finish doing a painting, it is your copyright. If you just put C circle and your name, so it means that it is your copyright. You don't have to apply. So this is very important for you to understand. So when you post something on, say, internet, some creative writing or painting, it's always put a copyright symbol and your name, unless you don't want it to copy it by anybody or everybody. If you want to authenticate your right, you should just do that. But then what benefits you get while filing for the copyright? you when somebody is infringing your idea, somebody is infringing your whatever your creation, you have to have a copyright registration before you initiate an infringement proceedings. So that's where the copyright helps. But day to day, if you are creating a lot of things, you don't have to go and apply for a copyright. But the moment you finish creating, it becomes your copyright. So this is something very important you can understand. So there is a very important story of copyright case laws. If I can share that with you. It was your late 1800. There were two sisters, Madrid Hill and Patty Hill. They were kindergarten teacher in Kentucky. And they wrote this song, Happy Birthday to You, with the same lyrics. And this Happy Birthday to You song, they were teaching in the lyrics of Good Morning to You. And then finally, they converted into Happy Birthday to You. And then in 1920, this rights of this Happy Birthday to You was bought by a company called Samian Company. Now, before that, if I can ask you another question, what do you think, how many years the copyright protection lasted? How many years do you think you have, if somebody writes a copyright, what do you think, how many years you get this right? So in case of trademark, we saw it is perpetual, and other different kinds of IP, you will get different years of protection. In case of copyrights, what do you think, how many years you get the protection? Yeah, you can put it in the chat box. What do you think, how many years your copyright would last? If you write a book today, how many years you think you will get the copyright royalty, you can collect the royalty for this book? This may be 10 years, 50 years. Yeah, you can. So far, no answer. So how many years... It's okay. We can. It doesn't matter if it is wrong or right. Let's. I mean, it is interesting to know how many years you think if you write a book, how many years you can get benefit the benefit of your writing. Years, yeah, Mr. Akhay, he's quite close to the answer, but not exactly. Any other answer? So this is life of the person who created plus 60 years. Suppose you write a book today, your life plus 60 years after that, your children or your legal heir can get benefit of your creation. It's something very interesting. And there is no renewal fee in case of copyright. So isn't it interesting? There is no renewal fee and you can give the right, you can get the right for your whole life. Plus you can pass on that right to your children also. So coming back to our story, what happens in Happy Birthday to You song. In 1920, Samian Company got this right. And then in around 1980s, Samian Company was taken over by this Warner Brothers. And once they got this right, they started collecting royalty fee for playing this Happy Birthday to You song. And it was one of the most popular song according to the Guinness Book of World Record, four-stanza song, but it was the most popular, most celebrated song in the English literature. And this company started charging royalty fee around $700, around 40 to 50,000. If somebody has to pay this company, if they play this song tune, Happy Birthday to You, even once. They started collecting from the clubs, theaters, movies, wherever this song is played, they started collecting the royalty fees. They started collecting almost 2 million per year royalty for this simple and popular song. Then in 2010, according to them, according to the Warner Brothers, the copyright of the Happy Birthday to You song was supposed to end in 2030. we should have been right now in the period of the copyrighted protection period. And if you wanted to sing the song in the family or in gatherings, so you were literally infringing the rights of another company. But what happens in 2010, there is one another law professor, he came out and he did some sort of research and he found out that because there is change in copyright law in US, the copyright was ended around 2010 and there was a big case loss. And finally, 2014, the court decided now this song is no more in the copyright protection period. Now it is now public. Now it is anybody from public can use it. And not to pay any royalty fee to the company. Otherwise, you would have been paying this royalty to this company and you would have been infringing while paying this happy birthday to your song. So this is the strength of copyright protection. It is such a simple four stanza words and then four stanza, such a simple song, such a popular song and such a long history of collection of this copyright royalty particular song. So this is the stage of copyright protection. When you are protecting something, when you are creating something, it's worth looking for this protection, and that is the power of the protection. So these are the different kinds of rights that you get along with copyright. So let's move to industrial design. Industrial design is basically when you have a product, how does this product look? What is the aesthetic feature? What are the appearance of the product? It doesn't talk about the functionality of the product. The moment you talk about the functionality of the product, it goes to patent protection. But in case of industrial design protection, we only talk about the appearance or the aesthetic feature of the product. And this has to be new and original. And because the time of filing, but the day you file, you should not disclose this product to the public. This is something very important for industrial design protection. Whereas in trademark, copyright, you can start using, you can file for the trademark registration later. Copyright, even if you don't file also, it is your copyright. But whereas in case of industrial design and patents, these are the two IP rights. What happens, you have to keep it secret till the time you file for the design registration or patent filing. So it has to be new till the date you file for your application. And the term is like, it is only for 5 years, but you can renew it twice. So totally 15 years protection you get for the industrial design protection. This is one of the easily get IPR because what happens is you might have one idea for example, you have one idea for a cycle, a particular mechanism, particular way the cycle runs. You can have several design of the cycle, several colors, several patterns, several seat design, several handle design, and you can apply for new design for each particular version. So this is one way the companies make a lot of IP by protecting several versions of one product. Okay, so this is about industrial design. Then let's go to trade secrets. So trade secret is like, when we say trade secret means it is any commercially valuable information that gives your business a competitive advantage can be trade secret. So, and it is perpetual rights, like as long as you keep your secret, it is your trade secret. It could be a recipe, formula, any experimental method, any change in your experimental protocol, or it could be any customer list, vendor list, whatever is important for you as an individual, as a company, is your trade secrets. And what happens is challenges is like, it is identifying your trade secret. Sometimes because it is your trade secret, it is very easy for you to know. But you might not be realizing that this secret, this piece of information might be so much valuable to your competitor or to other company, which if they have this information, they could be at your level, which you would have taken 4 to 5 years to come out this. Because you would have got this experimental process. You would have designed this experiment, say 4 to 5 years after a lot of failure, you would have got this final method wherein you say that if I use this particular way of at 100 degree temperature or cooling at 30 degree. So this step is helping me, my product coming out in a better way. And whereas your competitor doesn't have that information, then if you think it is such an important piece of information, it is worth protecting through a trade secret agreements. And remember, we don't have a legislation for trade secret like we have a patent law, trademark law, copyright law. But whereas in case of trade secret, there is no legislation, it can be protected through common law. So you have to sign a trade secret agreement with the person whom you are going to disclose your trade secret, if you don't want the other person to disclose your trade secret. So this is how the trade secret protection works. There is nothing called you have to apply to the government and get some rights, because it is your trade secret, you have to maintain it, and you should have some mechanism, some sort of agreements to keep it secret. Okay, so next is patents. Patents, what we say, is one of the strongest form of IPR, because you are stopping all others in your idea stage. If you have put your idea such a way and you have filed for a patent, you got a patent grant, nobody else cannot just change a little bit and come up with the same product and process. You have all the right to protect the other person if somebody is infringing your idea. So it is what we say is one of the strongest form of IPR. And if I can tell a story of Walter Hunt, like we say that, as we discussed in the beginning, it need not have to be very complex idea that you can protect for a patent. It can be very simple. It could be septipin. So, you know, septipin had a patent, like Walter Hunt in around 1849. So he was a mechanic. He was with a lot of innovative ideas, and he was playing with the 1/8-inch wear rod. And he had to pay $15 debt to his friend. And this $15 that he had to return, and then that day he was playing with this 8-inch wear long this wear thread, and then he came up this shape of the septipin, not exactly like what we see the modern septipin, but similar to this. And then he applied for a patent, because before that there was no septipin, remember. And if you have to stitch something, you have to literally stitch to get this stitch. But with the septipin, you can do a lot better thing, lot many things which we are using till now. And he applied for a patent. He got the grant for this patent, and he sold this septipin patent to a company called Grayson Company for $400, because he had to give $15 debt to his friend. So he sold this, and this company, Grayson Company, went on to make millions with just this septipin patent. So it's so simple, so useful, and such a small invention, but the company, it was so useful for the company. So that's what I'm trying to say is, even the idea may be simple, but as long as it is useful, it is worth protecting. You never know what kind of value you get of this idea. Or what we say is exclusive right. Okay, so this is another question. How many years do you think the patent rights last? Probably might be a little more aware about patents, because as I understand, you are all from technology background, engineers. So you might have a lot of hearing a lot about patents nowadays. So what do you think? How many years your patent rights last? Because it is one of the strongest, you remember, and you literally can stop anybody who is copying your idea by a case law, by a lawsuit. So that time is very important. How many years you get this protection? So what do you think? How many years you can protect your patents? I think we should get some few good answer here. How many years you think your patent right would last? Answer. How many years you think? Maybe 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, 40 years. Remember, this time of protection is very important in each of these IPR. Okay. Any other answer? Okay, can I request Mr. Akshay to unmute and talk about yourself? Because I see a lot of good answers and almost correct answer from your side. If I can request you to unmute and introduce yourself. So he has.
Good morning, ma'am.
Yes. Please introduce.
My name is Akshay, ma'am. I'm currently pursuing my MBA in second semester.
Okay. Interesting. So how you have a lot of this IPR? You have done anything or you have interest in IPR?
I have a little bit of interest, ma'am.
Okay. Okay. Okay, good. So he has given the right answer. It is 20 years. 20 years from the date of filing. Suppose you file a patent today. Today is 8th of October 2021. Your patent right would end in 8th of October 2041. Exactly after 20 years, your patent right would end. Irrespective of the time it takes the examination or prosecution or grant process, it might take, say, 1 year, 5 years, 6 years, 7 years, doesn't matter the prosecution, how long it takes to get you the grant. But the day you file, your clock starts ticking from that day onwards. So exactly 20 years from the date of filing, you'll have the patent right if it gets granted. Okay, so this is very important. And it protects only the claims because end of the patent document, you see we list a set of claims. Like suppose you are filing for this, you have filed for the septipin, you would have put it like, it's like my claim is for this 8-inch wear long device, which has a clasp for holding it, which you can use it this way, that way. So these are the set of claims that we put at the end of this patent document. So these are called claims. And these claims are called name of the game in the patent law is claims, because all the infringement, everything is decided in court around these claims. Suppose you say that I don't know how to write a patent document. I just told my attorney to my idea. This is how she drafted or he drafted. But then what happened? The attorney would have explained everything in the document, in the description. But she forgot to put it in the claim. And you thought as it is written in the description, it is your claim. It is your patent. But unless otherwise it is present in the claim, and it is giving the actual meaning how you want to put it in a claim. If it is not properly written in the claim, it is not your protection. So this is something that you need to remember. It only protects, your patent document protects only the claim. And what we say is through patent, you can exclude others from creating, producing, using, selling, importing invention. Means somebody else wants to use your idea, they have to take a permission from you to manufacture it or to use it or to sell it or to import it to another country. So these are the rights that somebody has to take from you if they want to use your idea. Okay, and we say that patent is not a positive right, because what happens is you might have some kind of a product patent. Say, for example, you have a chair and you say this chair is so good. It has a smoothness, the smooth wheel, no friction, and you don't have any trouble sitting in this kind of chair, and you can sit for longer duration without any neck pain, back pain, and all that. So suppose you have come up with this idea for this perfect chair, but and you got a patent also for that chair. But what happens is the way somebody is using the chair, maybe it is not good for his health. The kind of fabric it has been used in your chair is not good for the person, or the kind of manufacturing process is employed to manufacture this chair is not good for your environment. The metals that they have used is not good for environment. You may not get a pollution control board clearance to manufacture this chair, or it might have an earlier dominating patent which you might have some issue if you have to manufacture. So what we say is a patent is not a positive right. You everything, but it may not give you the permission to manufacture straight away, because you have to have all these clearance before you go for a patent protection. Okay, so this is something that you need to understand. And if you could just go by some sort of this is something previous patent, like history of patent, like we saw that 1474, the first Venetian patent statute was created, and then first US patent was granted in 1790. Any idea when you think your Indian patent was granted? When was the first Indian patent was granted? So first Indian patent was granted in 1856. We are not that far behind. It was a patent number one. It was for a pankha pulling machine. Was granted to an inventor named George Alfred D. Penny of Calcutta. So this is how our patent process started. And then we have the patent law and different, all this trademark law, copyright law, all this started in 1900s. And it has been polished and refined afterwards. Okay, so little bit, we'll just cover what are the requirements for the Indian patent law, how does it help the inventor. So there are five requirements typically when we say. So your idea has to be a patentable subject matter, means whatever idea you have, which is allowed under Indian patent law, that yes, this can be patented. Suppose you said, I have an idea for a particular plant. It can make, say, 10 different variety of roses and you want to file for a patent. But plants are not patentable in India. So even if your idea is so good, everything else it qualifies, it has some utility, it has some newness, it has some non-obviousness, it has some, you have put it in such a nice way, you have drafted a specification. But because the plants are not patentable in India, you will not get a patent. So it has to be under the allowed subject matter, then only it can be patented. So these are the things has to be there. All the certain characteristic of the your idea should satisfy all these five steps, then only it can be awarded a patent. Now, what are the things that are not patentable in India? First thing we need to understand, to be a worthy of patent, it has to be either a product or process. As per Indian patent law, it has to be either a product or process so that it can be patentable. And if there are certain things that, that are listed in Section 3 and Section 4 of Indian Patent Act, if your idea falls under those sections, they are not patentable. Now, what are those things that are listed in Section 4 and Section 3? So I've just given briefly. So if your idea is something against the natural law, against something public order or morality, or if it's something about scientific principle, or if it is a, just a new property or mixture, new use of known property. Say, for example, you have some kind of a drug, you know it is working for epilepsy, but you have found out that it is also, it can also work for cancer. And you want to file another patent for this particular composition, medicine for cancer use. So that is not allowed. New use of known things are not allowed under Indian patent law. Agricultural method, medical methods, plants, animals, they are not patentable in India. Mathematical algorithm, computer programs, copyrightable works. So these are not patentable as per Indian patent. And method of playing game, mental art, integrated circuits, tradition knowledge. So these are the things, they are not patentable. So when I say computer program, means computer program per se. You have written some algorithm. That algorithm per se, you can't file for a patent. But say you have an algorithm embedded in your washing machine. That is patentable. If your software is as a part of the mechanical device, it is helping the device, the mechanical device to work in certain way because of this algorithm. So that way you can protect your computer program, but not the computer program person. This is very important for all of you to know. Atomic energy, any invention or idea related to atomic energy are not patentable because they are related to our national security. If there is anything like that, usually the government of India takes into that, looks into that, and they kind of get that patent, but usually not allowed for the public use. And yeah, this we discussed. Yeah, there's another thing. We said when we talk about this different kind of IPR, there are basically two IP. There you have to have absolute novelty at the time of filing. So what are those we discussed in the beginning? Anyone you remember? Like you have to keep it secret till the time of file. We talk about say patents, trademarks, copyrights, industrial design, trade secrets. So out of this few things you can go to public, but you can file for a registration or grant later. But out of all this, there are two IP rights which you have to keep it secret till the time you file to the government agency for the protection. So those are industrial design and patents. If you have any idea related to industrial design, design of your product or patent, you have to keep it secret till the time you file the patent application. If you, suppose you want to file a patent today, 8th October, and yesterday night you said, okay, I want to just put it out in Twitter saying that I have this idea, just it is maybe 100 words that you can put in Twitter. And anyway, just 100 words, I didn't disclose everything in detail, but still you have lost novelty of your idea. If that is what something important elements of your idea, and you have already put it out even one sentence in your Twitter account, still you have lost novelty. So if you see one interesting case here, it was in 1960. What happens is there was one ship which was drowned in Kuwait harbor, and then this harbor was connected to Kuwait drinking water system, and this ship was carrying 5,000 sheep. And it was so important that this ship was should be pulled out as quickly as possible. Otherwise, the insurance company has to pay millions because of this drowning. And that time, this Danish inventor, his name is Carl Krøyer, he came up with this idea. What he did, he put 27 million plastic balls to this drowning ship, and he pulled out easily. And he saved the insurance company millions of dollars that time. And this idea was so popular, so useful. So he filed for a patent in UK and Germany. And he got a grant also in UK and Germany, but his patent was denied in Holland. So do you know what was the reason of the Holland patent office? The Holland patent office said, so there was this children's magazine, Donald Duck magazine in 1947, wherein this Donald Duck used a similar technology, similar method to pull out a downing yacht. So the patent office said, the Holland patent office, it is believed that the Holland patent office said, so this idea is no more novel. It is already disclosed in a kind of story to a children magazine. So remember, everyone, that it was 1960. That time there was no internet. If the examiner has to find out the novelty of your idea, they have to literally search all the documents, magazines, patent, non-patent document to find out whether your idea is novel or not. And remember, we are in 2021. Here, all the examiner, just by click of the button, they have the information across the world. Everything translated and given to have, they have separate access. So they know everything wherever you have written. Maybe it's a Twitter, maybe it's some grant application, maybe in some kind of conference you have talked about, maybe the conference proceedings would have that a summary of your idea or presentation. So they have all the information, whatever, wherever you have put it out. So it's always important that if you are planning to file for a patent, keep your idea secret till the time you file for your patent application. And if at all you have to disclose to somebody, if it is required by you, you must sign one non-disclosure agreement with the person you are disclosing. So this is the importance of novelty, and to maintain this novelty till the time you want to file for a patent application. Now, there are several databases where you can do a patent search just to understand your idea, whether it is new or if it's already been patented by somebody. So there are some free patent databases available, and there are some paid databases available. You can just do initial search to find out if idea is new or not. And as we said, patent document, you have to keep it secret till the time you file for a patent. And all the patent documents get published 18 months after you file the application. So when you read a patent document, you get a lot of information from the patent application itself. You get a lot of the technology-related information, because these are all new. People do not have disclosed to anybody before they file for a patent. So whatever coming out in a patent document must be technologically advanced features or things that is happening in that particular domain. Lot of legal relevance, because you get to know about your competitor, person who has filed, from which country, what kind of technology, you can know about that, or you could have some commercial relevance, you can find out about your business, locate your business partner. Okay, somebody's working on some kind of a chip mechanism and you are working on some kind of software part of that chip. Okay, I can collaborate with that person to come out with a fine product. So you can get all this information from a patent document. Now coming to patent portfolio. So if you have idea for this pen, for example, and this pen is a writing instrument, what we say in case of technical legal language, a writing instrument. We don't say it is a pen. We have to define what do you mean by a pen. Like, it's a writing instrument and it has a certain way that the inks flow smoothly and you can write it such a way that you want to have a patent for this pen. And you can file for a patent application for the pen, the functionality of the pen. And there's something called utility model, which is available in China and US. The small incremental invention of this main idea, say the grip or the pipette, how it works, a little bit of improvement from the original idea, you can get a utility model application. And the way the pen looks, it kind of tubular structure, how it looks, the industrial design application you can file because of the shape or design, how it looks. And some mark is there, which is suppose your name or your company name, that can be your trademark. You can apply for a trademark, what is printed on this pen. Or if you have put some design logo, suppose that can be protected through a copyright application, if some artistic design. So from one idea, from one pen itself, you can have so many IP created. You can have a patent, you can have a utility model, you can have industrial design, you can have a trademark, you can have a copyright, you can have so many different kind of IP created from just this pen. So this is how you built your IP portfolio that we say. You can have a many different kind of IP from one idea or several ideas. Okay, so these are some good patent practices that we say that if you're planning for filing of a patent, then you must avoid putting out your idea in seminar, lectures, workshop, disclose your idea to somebody or put it down in your website, journals, and offering for selling, advertising, putting out in your advertising brochure. All these things you must avoid if you're planning to file for a patent, because tomorrow you never know what the examiner would uncover. Because you might think that, okay, this is just a simple advertisement and some brochure I put it. You never know if that is recorded by somebody, that may be available in media by somebody. So, and may so happen that your examiner might find out, because if there is a dispute on novelty, you can't do anything. If there is any kind of argument based on the inventive step, suppose the examiner says that okay, this is something simple idea, it is, there is no inventive feature in this, you can still argue that nobody knows about it, I have came up with say 5 years of research on all that. There's some way you can argue. But if it is a question of novelty, if the data says that you have already published it by you or by somebody, if the idea is known to public before your data filing, you have absolutely no way to argue that, because that's a fact-based question. Okay, so this is the overall thing that we discussed. And with this, we are closing our presentation, but would be happy to take up some questions if some of you have some question related to any kind of IP and IPR. I think you can, if anybody, you can unmute and ask. Here, I think there's a question Mr. Ravi has asked. How much time they take to give approval after filing the patent? Okay, so typically you get, you can say 4 to 5 years to get a patent grant. It is across the world almost same. In US also around 4 years, you say. In India also 4 to 5 years. But there are two ways you can expedite your patent prosecution. If you have a startup company, or you are entering India through a startup international route. You have filed your application in international filing, there's something called PCT, Patent Cooperation Treaty. If you have filed there and they're entering India through PCT, you have an option of expedite your patent prosecution process. Or if you are a startup registered in India, you have some sort of certificate of startup, DIPB certificate that we say, through that process also you can expedite. Rest all of the cases, it is regular process. It takes 3, 4, 5, 6 years depending on the timeline. any other question, you can unmute or you can put it in the chat box also. If you have no question, then probably we can wind up the session.
Yeah, madam.
Yeah.
They would verify this logo. Supposing we wanted a logo to be as a patent trademark. So you would like to have that once we file it. Will they verify globally? It's been, if somebody is using or what is the verification process? Because it takes about 4 to 5 years.
Okay, so there are two questions here. When you are talking about logo, it is a trademark.
That's
when
right.
When I talked about 4 to 5 years, that is for patent. So your question is for patent or your question is for trademark?
Patent.
Patent, yeah. It's a very good question. So what happens is when we file a patent, the patent is actually for particular country. These are all based on jurisdiction. Okay, so if you file for a patent in India, you get the right in India. So this is how all the IP process work. There's no international patent, there's no nothing called as international logo registration or international patent registration. It's all based on the country wise. Okay, but when the examiner examine your idea, whether it is novel or not, the examiner would examine across the world. Your idea has to be novel, should not be disclosed by you or by anybody across the world. This is very important for all of you to remember. Idea would be validated across the world, but the rights you get only in that particular country. Did I answer your question?
Yeah. Yes. Thank you.
Dr. Lipika, I've got one question. Now, there might be certain tweakings in a product as such. You showed an example of a cycle or a safety pin or something. So if we actually tweak that product a bit, like in Indian terminology, we use the word jugaad as such. So suppose we do some jugaad and tweak a product, is that product becomes eligible for a patent?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. In US, I talked about utility patent. US and China, we have that. If there's a little bit of modification, you get another PT patent, or we say utility model patent. But in India, those patents are not available. Now, when you say you tweak the existing idea by you or by somebody else, now the question comes is whether the tweaking is good enough to stand the test of inventive step. Because we realize that there are 5 requirements of a patent application to be granted. One of them was no inventive step. It should not be obvious to another person working in the same technology. If it is obvious, then definitely won't get a patent, because the examiner would say, okay, it is just little bit of changes. You would have just little bit of changes in your manufacturing process, or the product has only just additional features, so it cannot be patented. But suppose you say that tweaking has helped you to achieve, say, 40% more yield in your product development process, or it has reduced the cost by, say, 50% or 60%. The tweaking is so important. If you can prove, then definitely you can get a patent out of it. But if it is just one of the method of doing it, and already it has been known, and you are just done some changes, which is anybody can come up with that changes, definitely the examiner would not allow such.
And who's the examiner? Like, suppose these kind of tweakings is done, so can be sent for patent to external countries also, or it has to be applied in India itself?
Oh, it depends on where you want your protection. You want your protection in India, then you have to file in India. You want to have the protection in US, you have to file in US PTO, US Patent Office. So every patent office have their set up examiner, and examiner are qualified professional in different technology. So you will have a software engineer, software background, biology, pharma, chemistry, different kinds of background. Depending on the application, these patent applications are assigned to those examiners. So they are well-versed in technology, they are well-versed in legal matters, how to give a grant of the patent, and they examine. It's same case for all the country.
Last question from my side. Can an idea be patented?
Yeah, I mean, patent office doesn't ask you to produce the prototype or produce the model of your idea, but it has to have certain way that you would have explained your idea in a document that somebody else can practice that idea and get the same result without coming and asking you. If you can put it in such a lucid manner, you get that patent. But to prove your idea is true, you have to validate in such a way. Examiner would expect you to validate. Suppose you are saying that you have some sort of device, some kind of equipment which would help you to, say, lose weight, for example. But then you have to show some validation because you can't just put it out only theoretical way. So the first application, the provisional application, you can file, you can put it out the overall idea. But when you come to the complete specification of your idea, the claims of your idea, you have to validate. How did you validate your idea? Just idea will not help unless you validate your idea. So for that reason, you require. But patent office would not come and ask you, show me your product, show me your prototype. That doesn't require, unless otherwise the examiner has a lot of doubt that I don't think can be done. I would like to see the prototype. That time they might ask you, but typically it is not required if your idea is so clearly described in your patent document.
Thank you so much, Dr. Deepika.
Okay. Any more questions?
Prince, do you have any questions?
Ma'am, there is a question in the chat box. There is a question regarding technology transfers memorandum of understanding.
What about technology transfer or transfers memorandum of understanding? Yeah, when you have to transfer your technology or idea to somebody else, you have to have these are some certain kind of agreements that you sign. And then these agreements would encompass all the clause related to your technology, what is the rights that you are going to transfer, whether you have filed any patents related to this idea, and what about those patents, who's going to be the ownership, and is it going to be a licensing agreement, is going to be an assignment agreement. So all this technology transfer would talk about this. So this is typically when you transfer your idea, your ownership of your idea to one to other. So you would require this kind of technology and a transfer memorandum.
I guess there is no more queries or questions as such.
Okay, I think.
Yes, ma'am, we can conclude.
What about apps, madam? Today, so many people are developing their own apps and all, no?
So that's what, if yeah. There's apps, just app per se, if it's just an algorithm, just a software per se, it's difficult to protect. But if your app is helping some sort of...
like Paytm, Google Pay, all those things.
Yeah, so if there is a technical feature enabled in the app, that can be protected. But you say, I have a set of algorithm I want to protect through patent, so that will not be possible. But you say, I have this Paytm app, which would help people, technology help seamless transfer of funds from one donor to receiver, and some kind of way you can do it. If you can describe in such a way, that system is patentable. But just app per se, somebody log in and getting some information and doing something, it is very difficult, or the claim that you get is very narrow.
Just a small question. Basis this again. Now, Paytm and Google Pay are quite similar. I don't know which came first, which came later, but how did the second one get the patent rights, because both are very similar in features.
Yes.
And you are telling that a tweaking of more than 40-50% should be there. So how did the second one?
No, I want to repeat here. I did not say 40-50%. I say
approximately.
If the the tweaking is so important that it gives a lot of value. So I mean, say it might be some kind of product you are getting that better than the previous one. That tweaking helps, or maybe the cost has reduced. The tweaking has helped. If the tweaking has not helped the existing feature to the new feature, so that will not be of any use to file for. Now coming to Paytm and Google Pay, what would happen is the kind of technology they would have involved may be different. Google Pay, where the information goes out of India, that kind of different platform, different server use. Paytm is something, maybe it is within India, because it is not just the front end we are talking about. When you're talking about a patent application, we are also talking about back end and front end both. And if both put together, if it is something unique feature, even if it comes first or the second, still the second one also can be patented. Or maybe the Paytm might give you some other feature to plug in with the different devices, or the Google Pay might give you some other option, some other kind of protection of your security, whereas the Google Pay would have different feature. So these are a lot of things happens in a platform like this. It is not just one of the option is you are able to transfer the money, but there are a lot of other things associated with that. So when we write a patent application, it is not just one claim that you apply for a patent grant. You would have set up, say, 5, 10, 20, 30, 40, even 100 claims you might have. So depending on how strong, how different is one kind of product from the other.
So you're talking about associated features.
Associated feature could be one way, because Paytm and Google Pay may look similar outset, but when you go into the technology part of it, the back end part of it, how the way they function, each of it may be different. And if you can bring out the different in the functionality of each product, definitely the second one, it can satisfy the thing, then it can be patented. What your idea is and how it is drafted, considering you have several prior art, several already product available in the market. When the new product, when you are writing new patent application, you have to find out the difference already available with your idea to previously existing idea, and how are you going to project those ideas in your patent application. So it is not a qualitative yes or no, we cannot say now, but when you see the draft in hand, you see the idea in hand, and then you compare the existing ideas, then you identify the difference, then you take a call whether the second one can be patented or not. It is not always the second one can always be patented or cannot be always done. So it depends on case to case, depend on the technology. Yeah. So for example, Google Pay would have used certain way. Maybe Paytm had come across with some kind of integrating, ML or blockchain or some other technology to add it. So that can be patented because it's additional technologies involved. Okay.
Yeah. Ms. Rajeshwari, you can please close the session. Yeah.
Yes, sir. It was indeed a wonderful and interactive session, very informative. I am privileged to propose a vote of thanks for this wonderful session where Dr. Lipika has taken us through the nuanced framework relating to intellectual property. And she has touched upon the different aspects which are covered under the umbrella term intellectual property and different laws which will specifically cater to different aspects of product innovation and process innovation. So she has clearly given us a clear distinction on the protection that could be sought for a particular product, be it a process or novel ideas. What constitutes novelty was exemplarily explained by her, and the requisites for our patent documents, be it the strength of the Copyright Act. Indeed, it has been a very informative session. Hope all of you have enjoyed the session. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Lipika Sahu for her valuable time in enlightening us towards this intellectual property framework. I would like to thank Mr. Manish Ranjan, Dean, I4 and alumni relations, NCET, Dr. Geetanjali, HOD, MBA, EDCEL, Professor Balaji, Coordinator, IIC, Mr. Periyaswamy, Placement Cell, for giving us the tech support. I would like to thank our principal and management for being there to provide us with the infrastructure to conduct wonderful session. Thank you all. Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, I would also like to thank all the faculty and Dr. Ranjan and Dr. Balaji and Rajalashi Madam and all the faculty and Nagarjuna College of Engineering for this opportunity. I hope it was useful to the participants, and thank you so much, and wish you all the best with a lot of creativity and creating different kinds of IPs.
Thank you so much, Dr. Lipika, and we look forward to many more sessions from you. This being the first, I'm sure you'll help us out in that.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. My pleasure, definitely.
Dear participants, there will be a second session on creative entrepreneurship from 2 to 3:30 p.m. Kindly remember to log in for the session on creative entrepreneurship. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. Lipika. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.